Okay, so Ved, let's proceed ahead with your mock interview for ISRO, right?
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay, sir. Very brief academic information from your side, Ved.
Okay, sir. Good evening, sir. I am Ved Prakash Sharma. I am from Silvar, Rajasthan. And after my schooling, I did my graduation in mechanical engineering from GIT Jaipur. Then, sir, I joined and completed the M.Tech from MIT Jaipur in production engineering. And I have did some research work also on erosive wear performance of surface coatings which are deposited on aluminium and steel. And sir, I have 4 publications also.
Okay, so can you tell more about this research work which you have done?
Yes, sir. So actually, we did 2 samples. One is the aluminium AA6061 and stainless steel 304. And we deposited the coating of Al2O3 TiO2 on both the samples by the thermal spray process detonation gun. And we also did the aluminium nitride thin film by the spread film of only 175 nanometer thickness on both the samples. Mm-hmm. Then we did the erosion test on all 4 samples and we compared the Al2O3 deposited on aluminium and deposited on steel. And we compared the aluminium nitride thin film for both the aluminium and steel in the erosive environment. And we did FSM analysis, EDS analysis, and AFM analysis for our study purpose to characterize the sample.
So what is the industrial application of your work?
Sir, actually, in environment, there are many dust particles and then many small particles are there. If we are moving with a speed, then they strike over the surface and they erode the sample, they erode the substrate material. In every case, it is very high in case of aerospace, in case of launch vehicles of ISRO. It is very dominant. So this is very predominant mode of failure. So if we deposit a coating over the substrate surface, then it can protect or decrease the erosion rate up to the 50% or more than it.
Okay, so what are the various agents of erosion you are targeting?
Sir, actually, sir, erosion depends on a number of factors, like the property of the erodent material, the shape, size, density, hardness, and the property of material, like it's the ductile or brittle material. For the ductile and brittle material, the mode of failure is different. One is dominant at the lower angle, and one is dominant at the higher angle.
Right,
and it is also demand the carrier medium. We are talking about the air, or so actually it is 100 times more severe if we are talking in the air or as compared to water. Slurry erosion is not that much severe for the same initial parameters. It is more severe in case of air. So it also depends on the carrier medium, the pH and the oxidation factor also.
So the kind of coating you are talking about, that coating is same whether material is brittle or ductile?
Yes, sir, coating is same.
Okay, so it does not have any kind of variation if the material is brittle or ductile, because brittle materials have more cracks on the surface compared to your ductile materials.
Yes, sir.
So I think impact of erosion on ductile and brittle materials is both different.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, what happens if we are talking about a ductile material, the erosion rate is maximum near about 30 degree impact angle. Whereas in brittle material, it is not that much significant for that particular angle. Mm-hmm. If we are talking about a 90 degree normal impact angle, the brittle material means they get severe erosion as compared to ductile. So both the angle, both the materials, the erosion is significant at different angles.
And okay, so what kind of coating are you using with?
Sir, actually we are using the composite coating of Al2O3 and TiO2.
So why you chosen this one? Why this material?
Actually, sir, we studied a lot in the previous published paper, and we find that sir, no one is not that much studies published on this particular composite. This particular composition, a lot of people did the study on Al2O3 plus 13% TiO2. And sir, we choose 30% TiO2.
What is the specific reason for that?
Actually, sir, the Al2O3 is ceramic. And it is very hard. So if we want to bind the Al2O3, we need a ductile matrix. TiO2 is also ceramic, but the melting point of the TiO2 is low, lower as compared to Al2-3. Mm-hmm. So if we add more and more TiO2, the binding property, the binding performance of that coating becomes significant, becomes increased, becomes better. But if we are using more than 30%, then the erosion resistance of the coating decreases.
So what properties do you see for this painting material, the material which you are coating? So what properties this coating material should have? What properties the coating material should have?
The coating steel has about 200 HV hardness. If we deposit the coating, sir, then the hardness becomes more than 1000 HV.
Okay.
So the property of surface becomes, means hardness becomes five times more.
But then how it is different from case hardening processes like carbonizing, you know, nitriding?
So there are two things. One is that if we do the case hardening, then the base material composition near the surface gets changed. Second thing, we are not able to get this much of hardness.
Mm-hmm.
But if we do the coating, the base material composition remains the same. We are actually making a composite system of base material with a protective layer.
So what is the mechanism of coating? What is the mechanism you are using for coating?
Sir, coating for Al and thin film is different, and for Al2-3 is different. In case of Al2-3 coating, sir, we are using a thermal spray process by the detonation gun. Actually, what happens, sir, in thermal spray detonation gun process, the speed is about 3000 meter per second. We are achieving that much speed, and the temperature is around 4000 Kelvin. Mm-hmm. But it is very high. So what happens, there is a chamber in which the oxygen and fuel is admitted, and that mixture of the fuel is burned by a spark, and that spark produces a very sonic wave of sonic speed. Mm-hmm. After that, we introduce our feedstock powder. Mm-hmm. Feedstock powder is a powder which are made for the particular composition like Al2-3 and 30% AO.
Mm-hmm.
Already made powder, then that powder melted due to that high much high temperature and get the speed. And due to that speed, so
did you check the impact of temperature change on your coating?
Temperature change, actually, the coating diffusion time is very less, and we are simultaneously cool the sample by the compressor air.
Mm-hmm.
In that industry. So there are no that much effect of the temperature. There is no diffusion at all. But we didn't check in our study.
No, if I talk about the space application, temperature can be very high in thousands of degrees. You know, so temperature can be very high.
But the Al2-3 coating is only significant up to 600-700 degrees centigrade. It can not go beyond this.
Okay. So Ved, what are your favorite subjects?
Sir, my favorite subjects are material science, production engineering, and thermodynamics. Also, the means the application part of thermodynamics, the RAC power plant and IC.
Okay, so I think Avinash sir, you proceed ahead with material science and production part first.
Okay, sir. Hello, Brother Sukash.
Hello, sir. Good evening.
Good evening. So first of all, I would like to know what are the drawbacks of the methods that you used for coatings. You said thermal spray coating, in which the speed is around you're saying of 3000 meter per second. So what are the drawbacks of this coating, this process?
So the major drawback is that if the base materials don't have sufficient strength, or sufficient means capability to resist that high impact, it can buckle. Mm-hmm. This is a major drawback.
Any other drawback? There are industries nowadays who do not prefer to use thermal spray coatings. Instead, they are they are preferring to purchase new part, the application that they are looking to coat by this process. They are not preferring to this thermal to purchase a thermal spray coating, but they prefer to purchase new part, the worn out part. So why do you think this is the case. Yeah, exactly. This technique is so efficient, but it is not so common in industry because of its cost. Yeah, so thermal, this is the major drawback nowadays in industry. You know, the cost of coating is, you know, more than sometimes the cost of the component itself. So take this factor into mind also, that this one is.
Okay. So you are not audible.
What is wear?
What is it, sir? Sir, actually, the wear, if I come in the broad terms, wear is a degradation of material due to the mechanical interaction with the surrounding. It is a number of types of wears are there, like cavitation wear, erosive wear, abrasive wear. There are a number of wears are there.
Okay, so what would be the difference in a particle hitting the surface normally and at oblique angles? And if I say at the intermediate angles, it will how will it change the conditions of wear rate? How would it change the wear rate?
So actually, if the erodent particle strike over the surface with a normal impact angle, then the work hardening takes place over the surface, and due to the subsequent impact, it get fractured and crack will appear and the material degrade. But if the particle impact at the shallow impact angle, like 30 or 45, like 20, from 20 to 60 degree impact angle, then the major erosion mechanism is clogging or micro cutting, lips are formed over the surface. So both are the different mechanisms are there, but it has significant over the material. Means if we have a ductile material, then the clogging is significant. If we have the brittle material, then the micro cracking or the formation of craters are significant at the normal impact.
Okay, so what were your abrasive particles that you used for this wear testing?
So in our testing, we use silica sand of 125 micrometer size.
Silicon, how much was the size?
125 micrometer.
Okay, approximately 120. So what do you think, what is the hardness of silica?
Sir, we didn't measure, but in the literature, it is around 2000 HB. Or in Mohs scale, you can say about 7 to 8.
Yeah, okay. And what was the hardness of your coating?
Coating, sir, we didn't measure due to the pandemic. So that a number of tests pending are there. We only up to now we only did the erosion test and we quantify the erosion by the weight loss. So the same analysis and the hardness measurement and the cross-sectional measurement is pending now.
Okay, so if I ask you that we do not want to apply coatings on steel.
Okay.
So what would you suggest in that case? What we can do for improving the wear resistance of steel?
Sir, case hardening is the option, sir. We can do the case hardening because the erosion is the surface phenomena. If we protect the surface, if we enhance the property of surface, we can greatly reduce the erosion rate or erosion behavior of the coating of the base material.
Okay, you said that if a particle is striking at the surface at perpendicular to it, then it would work harden. But what if it is, already hard surface is there, then how would it affect the wear rate when an abrasive particle is hitting at normal to the surface?
So if the norm, if it hitting to the normal to the surface, that cracks may generate or the crater will form over the surface. By the subsequent impact of particles, that the size of the crack or the fragmentation will going to increase and material degrade.
So how did you, what was the thickness of your coating that you used on substrate? How much was the coating thickness?
For AL23 and AL2, the thickness is around 310 micrometer. And for ALN coating by the sputtering process, it is around 175 nanometer.
So how did you measure the thickness, coating thickness?
So actually, the sputtering thickness is showing on the panel during the deposition. But for the both the samples, we measure the thickness in the every machine by mounting it with the epoxy, and we polish it, and after that we put the sample in the every machine, and we measure the thickness.
Okay, so you used ceramic Al2O3 and titanium oxide.
Yes, sir, mixture of both.
Okay, so what is the impact of titanium when we add it to the steel?
Actually, sir, the melting point of Al2O3 is very high. If we add the titanium oxide, the melting point of titanium oxide is lower as compared to Al2O3.
No, my question is, what impact does this titanium make on the properties of steel when we use it as an alloying element inside the steel?
Okay, alloying is good.
Yeah, titanium. There is one, you know, when very, very important thing about the titanium. That's why I asked you this question. What impact does it have on the properties of the steel?
Sir, I don't know much about that. I know one thing about titanium. Titanium machining is the tank. Titanium is very difficult. But the impact, I am not able to recall.
Okay, no problem. Okay, so let us come to a little bit theoretical part now. So basic material science. What is hardening and what is tempering?
Okay. So hardening is a heat treatment process in which we heat the sample to a particular temperature, then hold it and cool it. This is the hardening. But in the hardening, there are many residual stresses are there, and the material is not in a visible form. So we do the tempering after the hardening. We heat it above means the temperature, which is lower than the hardening temperature, and we hold it and we again cool it. This is the tempering.
Okay. So what do you think, what changes there occur inside the material that it hardness is increased, the toughness is increasing after the tempering?
Actually, in hardening, the grain size is very, very less. So fine, we get fine grains of needle-like structure in martyr size. Mm-hmm. But if we do a tempering, the size, the grains are means readjusting it there. The grain size is increasing, that's why the ductility is increasing, and we get the tougher material compared to the hardening material.
Okay, what are the changes in phase changes that are taking place during this process, during tempering? Change in phase.
Phase is not changing during the temperature. Only the grain structure or the residual structure is. So the grain structure and the residual stresses is removed.
Okay,
so it depends on the temperature.
What do you know about the stability of martensite phase?
So martensite is a metastable phase. It is not that much stable.
Why is it so?
Because the other phase which are formed in that triple diagram, they mm-hmm. all are the means isothermal. By the isothermal process, by the equilibrium process, that those phases are formed, but the martensite is an athermal transformation. So this is not stable. This is not a equilibrium equilibrium phase. It's not a equilibrium transformation.
Non-equilibrium transformation. How? So how is it? So how is it not a non-equilibrium transformation?
Because sir, if there are two lines in that triple diagram, one is the martensitic start line, and one mm-hmm. is the martensitic finish line. Mm-hmm. If we hold in between, the microstructure will not change. It will remain the same. It will mm-hmm. only complete if we enter beyond the martensitic finish line. But in case of other steel, if we hold it in the curve is C type of curve. So if we hold, the microstructure gets changing for that particular temperature. So isothermally they get changing, but in the martensitic they are not changing if we hold at a particular temperature for a long period of time. It will remain the same.
What is the change in crystal structure from austenite to martensite?
So in austenite to martensite, so martensite is the some microscopic cementite in the ferrite matrix, and the cementite is the needle-like structure is there.
That is the phase. You are talking about phase. I am asking about crystal structure. What is the change in crystal structure from austenite to martensite? You are confusing phase with the crystal structure. Try to think of what is the crystal structure of a gamma iron?
FCC.
Okay. And what is for martensite?
It's BCT.
Yeah. So what is that?
Body centered tetragon.
Yeah. So, what do you think? What kind of transformation is this? Why do we call it diffusionless?
It's diffusionless. So actually, what happened? The carbon in its place remains there, but the shape of the lattice gets distorted. That's why it becomes BCC. Because the A and C, the length of A and C in cubic remains one, means remains same. But in the distorted model, it gets different. and we get a distorted model of the FCC phase, which is known as BCC.
Okay, so what is this austenitic stainless steel?
Austenitic stainless steel is a special type of steel which has 18% of chromium and 8% nickel. 18-8, this is the definition of that steel. 18-8. And which we generally give the properties of corrosion resistance and have the FCC structure.
So do you think this can be alternate to your coatings that you used in your research work?
So actually we deposit the coating on the austenitic stainless steel also, means on itself. The 304 is the austenitic stainless steel.
But austenitic stainless steel already have a very high corrosion and wear resistance.
So if we are talking about the room temperature, we are in our study, we didn't do the corrosion test on this. In my ample time, we did the corrosion test on 304L steel in my BTEC time. And so that temperature is around 700 degrees centigrade. So at that temperature, the corrosion rate of the 304, the base material, is very high. Even though, sir, we only did the microstructure study in BTEC time, we don't do the quantitative part. But when we are observing the scales on the both the samples in FSM, the scale is very fragile in case of means base material. So it is very adherent in case of coated material.
Okay, so so can you draw the passivation curve?
Yes, sir. Sure. So it's like that.
Okay, so tell me practically what is this happening in this
case? So actually what happens, in the starting, the corrosion rate is very high because of the base material is there and the oxide layer is formed very partially. Okay. And after that, if the oxide layer is non-porous, then the corrosion rate gets reduced.
Okay, so it means...
Because it will not provide a channel for the salt to enter.
Okay.
But after some time, the oxide layer keeps on increasing. So the oxide layer is not adherent to the surface and it gets spelled out. So then the same process will happen again. So this curve is repeating. After this point, the same curve is repeated.
Okay. now define what is the peeling wet worth ratio that will protect your corrosion rate?
Okay, so the peeling bed but ratio is the volume of the oxide divided by the volume of the metal that forms the oxide. And if the peeling bed but ratio in between one or two, then we said that coating is passive or coating is protective.
Okay, Vithikash. Sir, I think you can go ahead now.
Okay, so where the other subjects, what you said? Your favorite switch?
Sir, the thermodynamics, RAC and power plant and IPV.
Okay. So, can you tell me the difference between refrigeration and air conditioning?
Refrigeration and air conditioning?
Difference.
Sir, basic difference is that in refrigeration, we are talking about the cooling the desired space. But in air conditioning, we are not cooling. We are talking about the comfort. So, we are talking about the purity of the air and the velocity of the air, temperature of the air, the humidity of the air. But in refrigeration, we are only focusing the cooling to the desired surface.
Okay, suppose I give you the COP of a system as 0.9.
Okay, sir.
COP of the system is given as 0.9.
Yes, sir.
So, can it be used as pump and refrigerator both?
Pump and refrigerator both.
Can it be used?
One minute, sir. So it can be used for the refrigeration part, but cannot be used for the heat pump.
Why?
So in refrigeration, the desired effect is lesser than the work input. Means the heat. Actually, if the COP is 0.9, then the refrigeration effect we are getting in refrigeration is it will be the 0.9 of the work input. So it is lesser than the heat we are giving to the system.
Okay.
But in case of heat pump, it is 0.9 of the W input, but we are interested to heat up the space. It will not heat, means the giving energy is more as compared to the getting energy.
Okay, now you reverse this system. You reverse this system and tell me what is the efficiency of the engine so formed by reversing this system. I've given you a system with COP 0.9. Now reverse it and tell me the moment it becomes engine, when I reverse it, it may become engine. Tell me what is the efficiency of that system.
So the COP is of refrigerator means refrigerator.
That you tell. I given a system with COP 0.9 and reverse it, it becomes engine. You have to tell me what is the efficiency of that engine.
So it is 1.11.
Efficiency of engine is 1 by efficiency of pump, right?
Oh, sorry. It's gone to 1.11.
1.11 efficiency तो वैसे नहीं होती.
No,
100% से ज़्यादा होती क्या efficiency?
So it's around
0.48. Okay. So can you tell me about the Carnot cycle? What is the efficiency of engine based on Carnot cycle?
The efficiency depends on the temperature difference.
Okay.
It's not depend on the work input.
Why it is not possible to design any system based on Carnot cycle?
So actually, the isothermal Carnot cycle has the two isothermal process and two adiabatic process. All are the reversible. If you are talking the ideal Carnot cycle, but the isothermal process is very slow. If we are not talking about the heat change, and the adiabatic process is very fast, so it is not possible to adjust the process likewise. And if we are talking about the Rankine cycle, so it is impossible to make it Carnot. But we are achieving to the Carnot by the regeneration.
Mm-hmm.
We are moving towards the Carnot, but we can't achieve that.
Then what is the advantage of having Carnot cycle, and why do we analyze it? When it is not practically possible to make any kind of device on the basis of Carnot cycle, and the assumptions made in Carnot cycle are also not practically feasible, why do we study Carnot cycle? What is the advantage of that?
So actually, Carnot cycle is ideal cycle for all the cycles, and it has the highest efficiency.
But other cycles are also ideal cycles, like Otto, Diesel, Brayton, Rankine. All these are ideal cycles.
Because we are not considering the losses in there, they all are ideal. But in Carnot, the efficiency is highest. We can't go beyond that. So if we are approaching towards the Carnot. So this is the our aim is target in Carnot cycle. We are moving towards that for the better efficiency of our.
Can you name some more cycles or systems having efficiency similar to Carnot cycle?
Yes, sir. The Stirling cycle is there, which has the same efficiency, and the Ericsson cycle is there, which has the same efficiency.
No,
the Carnot.
Ericsson and Stirling have different efficiency. Can you tell me why the Carnot cycle is the most efficient?
So actually, the heat injection is only in there. The two isothermal processes are there, and in the adiabatic. So the heat induction is not there, so there are no loss in these two processes. And
so if heat interaction is only in two processes, is that the reason why it is most efficient? Or that heat addition is at maximum temperature?
Yes, sir. One thing is there, sir, that efficiency we can write is that T mean of heat addition, T mean of heat rejection divided by T mean of heat addition. So in car not we add the whole heat at the same temperature. We not do this in the other cycle. So the temperature range is constant and we are getting the temperature highest and lowest in the efficiency formula.
Okay, now Erichsen and Stirling, do you add heat at constant temperature in Erichsen and Stirling?
No, sir.
So if you don't add heat at maximum temperature and reject at minimum temperature, then how can Erichsen and Stirling be as efficient as Carnot?
Sir, actually they are not efficient as Carnot, but we can achieve the Carnot by the slight modification.
How? How do you make that modification? And can you make that modification in Rankine cycle also?
Rankine?
Yeah.
Theoretical we can say, but sir, it is not practically achievable.
There is a term called ideal regeneration.
Yes, sir.
You know what is ideal regeneration?
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, in ideal regeneration, we heat the means the entering water same as the steam at the temperature.
Okay.
Internally within the turbine, but it is not possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think we give the feedback now. Abhinesh, please go ahead with your feedback.
Okay, sir. So Ved Prakash, please study a little bit more about this Martin city transformation. Okay, so and second thing that I questioned you, titanium is actually considered a strongest carbide former element. Okay, so that's why I asked you, you used titanium oxide, and what could have been the effect if we used titanium as an alloy in the steel. And the next thing is, when you talked about austenitic stainless steel, then you need not to mention actually exact percentage that it is 18%, because austenitic stainless steel have different chromium percentages in them. Okay.
Yes.
So it is generally, you can say from 11 to 30% you can add chromium to the steel. So need not to mention a specific. If you are asked about austenitic stainless steel, then try to answer in that way only.
Okay.
And nickel is there. So nickel is there to retain the austenite to the room temperature. So nickel is actually austenite stabilizer, you can say, by which we can get this austenite at a room temperature. Okay. And whenever you are asked about the wear mechanism effect of abrasive particle when it is hitting on the surface, then you first do mention that about what surface are you talking about? What kind of the substrate of the metal, not of the coating. Because abrasive particle have different wear rates on the brittle surface and this, you say, ductile surface. Yeah, the tough surface. Okay, so this was all from my side.
Now, Ved Prakash, you see, in ISRO, you're going for which interview?
So
ISRO, right. In ISRO, no, this the kind of question they will ask you is like they will check the approach. They will not be interested in answer, but approach. They will take one or two questions only and then go in deep, deep, deep about that. They will keep on asking you in deep about that and check your concepts. Like I asked you COAP 0.9. You should know that COP coefficient of performance of refrigerator varies from 0 to infinity, and for pump varies from 1 to infinity.
Yes.
Understand? Something like that. You should know that. There's a range of basically that. So COP is, you know, if you see the formula of COP, if let's take the engine. You know, engine coefficiency cannot be basically infinite, one. Engine coefficiency varies from 0 to 1. So reverse of engine efficiency is COP of heat pump.
Yes.
So COP of heat pump varies from 1 to infinity. Right?
Yes.
And COP of refrigerator is 1 minus COP of heat pump minus 1.
Yes.
So COP of refrigerator varies from 0 to infinity.
Yes, sir.
Now, what is given to you, 0.9? Can it be pump? No, sir. Why? Because, sir, pump has COP more than 1.
Yes, sir.
Very simple. And reverse that. If you reverse that, it becomes efficiency of engine. What is efficiency of engine? It is 1 by COP of pump. And what is COP of pump? It is 1 plus COP of refrigerator. And what is given to you? COP of refrigerator. So that kind of concept that you should know, okay, efficiency ka range kya hai, COP ka range kya hai, wo thoda sa mentally aapko pata hona chahiye. Carnot cycle sabse efficient kyun hai? Kyunki sir maximum heat jo add karte hain, जो सॉरी हीट ऐड करते हैं वो मैक्सिमम टेम्परेचर पर करते हैं, तो उसके अंदर का जो मैक्सिमम अवेलेबल एनर्जी वो हमने यूज कर लिया, और जब हीट रिजेक्ट करते हैं तो मिनिमम टेम्परेचर पर करते हैं, तो उसका जो हीट जो हमने रिजेक्ट किया वो मिनिमम अवेलेबल एनर्जी के साथ रिजेक्ट किया. दैट मीन्स वी आर यूटिलाइजिंग द मैक्सिमम अवेलेबल एनर्जी इन अवेलेबल इन द हीट एनर्जी. जो भी क्यू वन है जब हम उससे वर्क निकाल रहे हैं तो उसका मैक्सिमम अवेलेबल एनर्जी यूज कर रहे हैं कार्नोट साइकिल के अंदर. Now, there is no such cycle which actually matches with Carnot cycle. But yes, there are cycles in which two processes are adiabatic. Other two processes, two processes can be any other processes, you know, like isochoric, isobaric or something like that. Now, if you do ideal regeneration, आइडियल रीजनरेशन में आप क्या करते हो, एक प्रोसेस से जो हीट रिजेक्ट हो रही है वो दूसरी प्रोसेस को दे देते हो, वो एडियाबेटिक बन जाती है. नाउ यू नीड टू सी दोस प्रोसेसेस इन व्हिच टू प्रोसेसेस आर आइसोथर्मल. अदर टू प्रोसेसेस आर मेड एडियाबेटिक. हाउ? टेक द हीट फ्रॉम वन एंड गिव इट टू अदर. सो टेकिंग द हीट फ्रॉम वन गिविंग टू अनदर, तो हीट इज नॉट इंट्रैक्टेड फ्रॉम आउटसाइड. सो ideal regeneration is the way by which you can make any process as efficient as Carnot cycle. When I asked you, is there any cycle in your mind which is as efficient as Carnot? You should say, sir, by making ideal regeneration, by using ideal regeneration, which is a heat transfer process basically, I can make some processes as efficient as the Carnot cycle. That would have been the answer for that.
Yes,
clear? This is one thing. And I think the rest, your project looks like good. So introduce in the introduction, you tell about the project, and then from there they can ask you the questions.
Okay.
Right, Ved Prakash? So prepare on this line and prepare your project very well.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Ved Prakash.
Thank you, sir.